shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness and gracious, great balls of fire. I let the duck before I thought it was funny. You came along and moved me, honey. I changed my mind, this love is mine. Goodness and gracious, great balls of fire. Kiss me, baby. Feels good. Hold me, baby. I want to love you like a lover should. You're fine, so kind. I want to tell the world that you're mine, 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 mine. I chew my nails and I twin over thumb. I'm real nervous, but it sure is fun. Oh, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Good. Hold me, baby. I want to love you like a lover should. You're fine, so kind. Tell the world that you're mine, 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 mine. I chew my nails and I twiddle my thumbs. I'm real nervous, gonna be sure it's fun. Oh, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
If you ask me to name my three favorite NASCAR drivers who found their greatest successes before the modern era, three names I would give you would be Lee Petty, Tim Flock, and Fireball Roberts. Well, the first two make sense. They're the two of the best to ever do it. But why Fireball Roberts? The drivers whose accomplishments were overshadowed and pale in comparison to the likes of Junior Johnson, Ned Jarrett, and Buck Baker. Well, he was just a heck of a lot of fun to watch. He was Curtis Turner while Curtis Turner was still alive. A man who passed away at 35, but always seemed to be 12 at heart. And a driver who, if he had survived, could have done so much more, and probably would have captured a Cup Series title. This is an abridged story of Fireball Roberts, the man who I believe to be NASCAR's most underrated driver ever. Let's talk about Fireball. Let me get one thing straight right off the bat that I'm sure Robert's mother would praise me for. His given name was not Fireball. Born Edward Glenn Roberts on January 2nd, 1929, he was raised in Apopka, Florida, a suburb of Orlando. Roberts was a smart and athletic guy, a great combo for a soldier, but when he tried to join the U.S. Army Air Corps at the age of 16, he was discharged after basic. Not because of his age, but due to his asthma. Despite his condition, he was still in great shape and got his famous Fireball nickname for having an incredible fastball as a baseball pitcher. The family now being in Daytona Beach, Florida, though, meant he could pursue his other big passion, auto racing, specifically stock car racing. He competed in an unsanctioned race on the Daytona Beach circuit in 1947 at the young age of 18 and won the next year's event at the track, all while attending the University of Florida simultaneously. In 1950, he competed in the Daytona Beach race again, this time marking his aforementioned first official Cup Series start. Though he was only running a part-time schedule that year, he did notch his first win at Hillsboro, but despite his success as a rookie, he never latched onto the sport enough to run full-time at the start. He loved the Cup Series, sure, but he also liked to stay home with his family, and local dirt modified races paid just enough money to pay the bills and keep stomachs full. Why go on the road? However, in 1956, that was all about to change. Though overall it would be a short-lived opportunity, he got a chance most drivers in the early days of the sport would kill for. A factory team ride with fantastic backing. Driving for Pete DiPaolo, Roberts was able to run as close to a full-time schedule as most drivers could in those days, competing in 33 of 56 races in 1956, winning 5 of them. The next year, 1957, he ran as many races as he ever would in Cup, starting 42 of 56 and winning 8 of them, more than 1/6 of the races he started, as well as nicking a 6th place points finish. In 1958, he was back to going mostly part-time, but Roberts put together his most well-rounded season ever, in my opinion, despite only starting less than 20% of the Cup races that year. with 6 wins, 8 top 5s, and 9 top 10s, along with an average finish of 5th in just 10 starts, Roberts came home 11th in the points, somehow ending with a respectable bottom line in the standings, even though he ran hardly any races compared to the full-time or mostly full-time competitors. The next 2 years yielded just 3 wins in total, but in 1961 he got the first of his 2 5th-place points finishes, a career best for him, again while running a limited schedule, only starting 22 of the 52 races. However, in 1962, the biggest triumph of his racing career was on the horizon, and it happened essentially in his hometown.
Two laps to go. The last lap. And Fireball gets the checkered flag. His crew is jubilant. Roberts and his Pontiac wheels into the winner's circle. 500 miles at an average speed of 152.9 miles an hour. An amazing achievement for driver, car, and equipment.
Me and Sal had to dig him out.
Though the Daytona 500 was only 4 years old, it was already becoming quite prestigious through the entirety of the sports landscape, and thus the winner was always held in high regard. But in Roberts' case, it was different. The win was more meaningful. Not only was it in his hometown of Daytona Beach, but it also marked a small redemption arc for him against the sport as a whole and its founder, Bill France Sr. The win was almost like a suave middle finger to Bill France, because the one thing Big Bill hated more than anything was the prospect of a driver's union. And while 1969 didn't end well for him in that regard, Roberts won the 1962 500 had been somewhat of a blow to Big Bill's anti-union agenda. Roberts had been the president of a union that they, along with Curtis Turner and Tim Flock, had tried to start the following year, but it had gotten shot down, and in turn had gotten Flock and Turner banned from the sport as well as Roberts, though Roberts, when the ban was revoked, decided to come back, while the other two didn't. Glenn brought home an 8th place rank in 1962, along with 2 additional wins flanking his victory in the Great American Race. And in 1963, he put together his best season where he ran close-ish to a full-time schedule, winning 4 times and placing 5th once again in the points. 1964 seemed to be a solid season for him again, as he had a win, 5 top 5s and 6 top 10s and 9 races heading to Charlotte for the 5th annual World 600. Unfortunately though, fate would have other plans. Roberts passed away after nearly a month and a half battle. He suffered 2nd and 3rd degree burns, as well as breathing problems caused by his asthma. And pneumonia, when he seemed to be recovering, was the final nail in the coffin. He died on July 2nd, 1964, but like Dale Earnhardt, his death in an accident was not in vain. Fireproof suits and 5-point harnesses have become commonplace in motorsports, and the legacy of Fireball Roberts, whether it be on the baseball diamond, regarding safety, or in victory lane, will always be celebrated. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please click the like button, subscribe, comment, visit our Spotter Stand website, and share the video and the channel with your family, friends, or anyone you know who likes NASCAR. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Sam with Subs from the Spotter Stand, and I'll see y'all really soon in the next video. Goodbye.